The Lightblade Grandmaster Nightfall is one of the hardest GMs in the game and the hardest of Season 16. So let's talk about it. Weapon-wise, you are going to need Unstoppable and Barrier Champion mods. There aren't a ton of Unstoppable champions, and there are none in the final boss room, so I don't think you need more than two people on Unstoppable. You can definitely get by with just one, but if you wanted to play it safe, that's fine. But Arbalest is going to continue to be a very, very strong idea here, especially considering how mobile you need to be in the final boss room. The last thing you want to be doing is trying to plink away a barrier shield during the boss fight. Just use Arbalest. It's still super good. They would have to nerf it so badly for it to not be good anymore. Otherwise, we are focused on arc damage because of arc burn, which is indeed still in the game. Trinity Ghoul ended up being quite nice if you wanted to have two people on Arbalest, which I do highly recommend, although you can't go wrong with three people on it. I just liked having a little versatility in the fire team. Tarantula, the arc linear fusion, the only reason you're using this is because of the 25% damage boost from arc burn. That's it. If you don't have one, maybe Hothead could be a play after that, and then if you don't have Hothead, I would honestly just put on your best linear fusion. I'd probably just put on your best linear fusion before Hothead. The first time I cleared this place was with a solar linear fusion. I haven't tried any sort of G-Horn based play here. It might work because of how much ammo will be available to you. I just haven't tested it myself, so I can't really verify. Subclass wise, you're absolutely going to want to play defensive here, as one thing going wrong will spell the end of your run in the boss room, or anywhere else really. While I have cleared this strike both with and without a hunter, invis is an incredibly strong tool here, bonus points if you can make your teammates invisible. I ran this with two titans and one hunter, so we had one shield and one ward. Ward came in handy multiple times as a panic button and instant cover, worked very, very well. I would potentially even recommend Helm of Saint 14 to a degree if you have someone on Aeon Gloves already. I ran this with no hunters, and if you're doing that, you want a Stasis Warlock. You should probably just be on a Stasis Warlock anyway, regardless of hunter situation. I'm not going to recommend a Well of Radiance because the boss will absolutely kill you right through the well, and it's going to give you a very false sense of security. Nova Bomb is acceptable if you want to do some sort of controverse hold grenade weakness play, but I think Stasis is a much safer route to go, and I would go Stasis over Nova unless you have multiple Warlocks, and even then, double Stasis is going to make it that much easier. Suppression grenades are going to be really good here because of all the Lucent Brood, which you will want to try to suppress when possible. Mod-wise, we're doing double arc resist and striking light with the bonus damage resistance while sprinting buff active. You're going to be doing a lot of running around in the final boss room, a lot of sprinting around. Abuse Aeons and Lucent Finisher. This is, I believe, the only place with Lucent Brood and champions in it. Definitely should be finishing every champion and Lucent Brood and abuse the fact that you can get tons and tons of power ammo. Do not be afraid to burn your ammo on big targets. Otherwise, your standard finders and scav mods are going to do just fine. Taking charge and high energy fire is nice for a flat 20% boost on the boss or champions, since the boss has a rather thick health bar and also drops a bunch of orbs of power in the water in the boss room a lot. Exotics, Aeons, make sure they're A on your character. Hunters, you might want to play with Omnioculus to have a ton of chances to make people invisible, otherwise Orpheus is going to be just fine. I also know that there are some shenanigans with Renewal Grasps and Stasis Hunters, some clips going around of hunters literally sorting the boss and champions to death and not dying to the boss's melee attack. I have not run this myself yet, and I am hesitant to recommend it to the average player because one false move and it's over. You also need to be good with the Lament. But I would absolutely say that this is going to be an option for some teams. If you're unfamiliar with how it works, I would either avoid it completely or get familiar with it in easier content first and then try it out in the GM. Titans, Warlocks, pretty standard affair here. Use exotics linked with your subclass. Warlocks, that's going to be Osmiomancy Gloves for spamming Stasis Turrets. Also, stop running two or three resilience. Get your resilience up, at least five resilience. It does make a difference, trust me. Okay, let's get in there. The number one thing to know about the Lightblade is that basically everything deals arc damage. Knights, wizards, the boss, barrier champions, moths, thrall melee attacks are all arc damage. You want to avoid being hit as much as possible, especially by the boss, who will more or less one-shot you. The entrance isn't too big of a deal. You have a couple of barrier champions that will migrate towards the middle downstairs area, a couple of orange bar boomer knights, and a bunch of acolytes. I would advise dumping some power ammo into the boss to get him to leave immediately before doing anything else, since he's kind of annoying, and then finishing the champions to get your ammo back. This area should not be a huge deal to anyone who has done a GM before. The next room, however, is a much bigger deal, even to the most experienced GM runners. Multiple Lucent Brood, multiple champions, tons of adds, you are in for a ride. When you first enter, kill both the upper and mid-level wizards immediately. The mid-level wizard will be a little annoying trying to hide. You're gonna have two barrier champions and one Lucent Brood to start. I recommend taking out the left side barrier champion first, so that way you have a little bit of room to move around. After you kill one champion, then you can move to the Lucent Brood, who does not have nearly as much health as you might think. If you have an Invis Hunter, send them up to kill the ghost. One note before we move forward. Do not stay grouped up. Not here, not basically anywhere. The Lucent Brood will throw suppression grenades, and those grenades will one-shot you. They are very accurate. At the very least, stay spread apart unless you're going for a kill on a champion. And even then, you should try to stay spread apart. Ideally, someone will be watching Lucent Brood the entire time, doing callouts for when grenades are being thrown. Do not ignore this enemy. It's the same thing with the shield throws. If it hits someone, you are going to die, and then the ricochet is going to automatically target another player. You are going to have some BS shield deaths here at some point. There's not a ton you can do about it other than suppressing the brood when they super or just running away until it's over. Do not ignore the brood. There should be one person minimum who has eyes on it the whole time. Eventually, you're gonna have Lucent Brood number 2 spawn where you entered the room. Now, I believe the trigger for this enemy spawning is linked to acolyte kills. Of all the footage of mine that I've watched, this enemy has always spawned right after an acolyte kill. So I'm guessing that killing most of the acolytes in this room is the trigger for this second Lucent Brood, which, if that is the case, you want to try to avoid killing acolytes until you've killed the other big targets. If you get spawned on, then I'm sorry for not having the correct info, but this is one thing I'm not 100% about at the moment. Something I will recommend is that everyone stays near where this brood spawns in, because the ideal scenario is that you instantly kill this target as it spawns in. Hunters, drop a shadow shot on this brood if you have it, suppression grenades, whatever else you got, burn everything that you have on this enemy as it spawns in, and it should make your life easier. The only issue with this method is that by the time you're finishing the ghost, you're gonna have a lot of thrall spawning in and swarming you. A death here, I think, is actually worth the kill on the brood, because you can very easily clean up all the thrall and then res. Trinity Ghoul should be ready to support the person killing the ghost, and if you can go invis after a finisher, that's even better. If you are unable to kill this brood, then I will suggest the hallway strat. The hallway strat is where you back the hell up towards the hallway that you used to enter this room and simply kill what you can from the opposite side of the hallway. The brood will eventually make their way up, so you don't really need to worry about going out and peeking and trying to get their aggro or anything like that. What you do need to worry about are their grenades and their shield throws, because one shield throw can wipe you right here. After a certain amount of time later, maybe it's linked to kills, maybe it's a timer, I'm still not sure, you're gonna have a third Lucent Brood spawn in, Thrall, Acolytes, and two Melee Knights with yellow health bars. Tackle this however you want. You can continue to stay in the hallway and use it as a funnel, you can venture out. I would recommend killing the Knights first because they're gonna be in your face and they're going to one-shot you, followed by Thrall and anything that's really getting in your face. This room's a little tricky first time through. Play defensive, use the hallway if things start to fall apart, You know, you can even just restart the strike if you don't like how it's going. It's the first room. But the biggest advice I can give is watch the Lucent Hive. Grenades and supers will wipe you. Do not disrespect this enemy. Moving on is the boat section. Things don't really get too wild until the Crotus and Lamp section. You're gonna have two champions, one on each side of the boat as you approach, along with some adds, nothing really that special here. You're gonna have acolytes on the left and right side as you take the boat down. This is where Trinity Ghoul will shine. Don't forget about the Shrieker up high as well. It hurts really bad, and remember, you can't really use class abilities while the boat's moving because you'll just leave them behind, along with a couple of acolytes on the sides as you approach the first checkpoint. This section should be done one at a time, although experienced players can split up if they want to. You're gonna have one Lucent Brood per side. I suggest a suppression grenade immediately after they super and then just burn them down. Then you should try to get the other Lucent Brood on the opposite side weak from where you are, unless you have another suppression grenade. It's just so easy for them to shield throw you while you're all clustered on the stairs. Just play it safe. Send in an Invis Hunter, whatever you gotta do. Just don't cluster up. Moving into the next boat section, there's no rules that say you need to stay on the boat. You can, if you want. It's a little more intense, it's a little more fun. But you can also just bail immediately and run up the sides while you slowly kill adds. Watch out for Shriekers and Wizards, they hurt pretty badly, but there's nothing special happening here otherwise. You can take a portal to the Thrall jumping on the boat section as soon as everything is dead. This part can be pretty easily handled by Trinity Ghoul, and just by staying off the boat, take this slow, play it safe. Trinity Ghoul might need to jump and shoot a couple of times. Be careful jumping back onto the boat as it starts moving. It's a little wonky, and you might miss your jump. Then we have the Crota's End section with the lamps. This area is 75% Screebs, 20% Moths, and 5% non-sniper Raiders. Screebs basically do not stop spawning in until you start moving, so as soon as you get a good wipe on them, go, go, go. Trinity Ghoul will be doing the heavy lifting against the Screebs, while the other players should watch for the Moths that will activate and also the Raider that spawns in with the Screebs. You need to walk through the gates to activate the lamps, so find a path quickly and move as fast as possible. The less time you spend here, the better. Do not be afraid to use everything that you have here to survive. Raiders are an enemy that you will underestimate at first until one of them kills you. Then you will not underestimate them anymore. Titans should try to drop barricades in a way that the Screebs will walk into them so that they get stunned. Just make sure to stand far enough away from the wall so that they're not jumping through it and self-destructing on you anyway. The key here is speed. Keep moving and keep looking around for Screeb spawns. Just because Trinity Ghoul is good at killing them doesn't mean you should not help kill Screebs. If someone dies, try to get them up if the timing works, but otherwise, you might just have to move on without them. Once you get to the end and once your darkness stacks fall off, you can go back into the section and res people up. Worst case scenario, you just have your hunter invis spam themselves to the end and then res everyone up. This place might require a practice run or two to really get the hang of. The next two sections, post-lamp and then pre-boss, aren't anything special. This is where the unstoppable champions are. Post-lamp, just kill stuff. It's pretty standard affair here. Watch for snipers that I think exist, and then also watch out for moths. The pre-boss section has a lot going on with the giant ogres, the unstoppables, the shriekers. Just take this one enemy at a time. The big ogres actually deal a lot of damage. They can kill an unstoppable abomination very easily if you just stun it a couple of times. Plink away here at the targets, watch for potential Screebs that might scale the wall, but this isn't anything too crazy. And again, shoot the boss to make them go away because the boss still hurts really badly. Watch for the Shriekers on the left and right side as you get closer to the boss arena. Okay, time for the boss. A la cool. Is a very tough encounter, but there are some tricks that you can employ to make things a bit easier on you. In fact, the first third of the fight can be pretty simple. When you drop in, first off, please be careful, don't die here. Secondly, take out all of the thrall that spawn in when you start the fight. They're gonna jump up and down, chasing you all around, take them out. You aren't really gonna get any super threatening enemies besides the boss until the first third of their health bar, which I'm just gonna break up into phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3. So during phase 1, you get to practice a couple of things. The number one thing is kiting. If the boss is aggroed on you and you're near the edge of something, you can take this time to kite him back and forth between platforms. By jumping to different levels, the boss will follow you, which means he is jumping, which means he is not shooting you. You can do this in the first phase without much issue at all, since he is the least aggressive during this phase. Just be aware that the boss may occasionally not immediately chase you and instead opt to shoot you or someone else. This kiting technique can be done during a good amount of the fight, but as the fight progresses, he gets more and more aggressive, which means you might not want to do it as much. You can also practice avoiding his shots. His shots hurt really badly. Even the splash damage hurts really bad. It'll just kill you. Do not stand against the back wall on either floor. The splash damage will kill you. Try to put yourself in the middle of cover and a wall far enough away that the splash damage is not going to hit you. These little, I don't know what to call them, but short little things on the top level of this arena, these are bait. Do not use these to hide from the boss's shots, because the splash damage from the boss's shots hitting the wall next to you will kill you. Use the main pillars, like the archways that kind of form around the entire upper ring. Honestly, a great strategy is to jump up high behind a pillar, since the walls towards the ceiling are so thick that no damage is gonna get through at all. I would avoid being on the run when possible, because the boss will track your movement based on where you're actively going pretty darn well, and a shot can tag you and kill you. Try to move between bursts or while someone else is being attacked. After you get a boss down a bar, aka done with phase one, a Lucent Brood and two melee knights with arc shields will spawn on the center platform. You do not need to deal with the boss during this time. The knights will chase you, the Lucent Brood will also likely chase you, but has a chance of being more passive. This is a great time for a Shadow Shot or a Nova Bomb right as they all spawn in, but if you wanted to save it for when champions spawn in, which is basically immediately after, that is fine as well. Rip the arc shields off and get these guys down quickly. I recommend killing the knights first and then the brood. I'm not exactly sure which event triggers phase two, killing all of the enemies or killing the brood specifically, but we killed the brood last every time and that worked for us. So that's what I'm gonna recommend to you. After the boss reactivates, when phase two starts, you are going to have two champions, barrier champions, with a handful of acolytes per champion spawn in on top of the boss roaming around. So it's basically gonna be kill Lucent Brood, and then boss reactivates and two champions spawn in. The thing about these spawns is that they're kinda random. In one run, they both spawned on the right side of the room if you're facing the giant statue in the room, and they will also spawn on the top level every single time. In another run, it was one group on the left and then one group on the right. This is something you're just gonna have to vibe in the moment. What I can suggest is non-stop kiting, killing acolytes as you get the opportunity. The best case scenario is one person has the attention of the boss and the other two players find an isolated champion and take it out immediately. Otherwise, you're just gonna need to find a good moment for all of you to take out the champions. If you're a stasis warlock, throwing a grenade turret in the middle of a spawn of this group of enemies is very much advised. Do not be afraid to continue running around until you have that perfect timing. You should have plenty of time. Don't rush a kill if you don't have to. After that, another wave of champs, just like this one, will spawn in at 50% health, and you're gonna do the exact same thing. Kill acolytes when you get the chance, then kill the champions while kiting the boss. He will also go into angry mode, where he is much faster and aggressive in chasing you. At 33% health, the end of phase two, you will do another wave of the two knights and one Lucent Brood, followed by a small wave of Thrall after the boss is released. And then after another chunk of damage, you will do another wave of acolytes and two champions, but this time there are gonna be Thralls as well. Now, I don't know if this was a coincidence or not, but of the two clears I've gotten of this place, the champions that spawn in at that, let's call it 20% health marker, spawned on the right side close to the statue. So I would prepare for that, but just be ready for anything. It should be handled the exact same way. All of these instances of acolytes and champions spawning in sounds very tame, And in most other strikes, you would be right. But it's because the boss is so lethal, along with the champions, along with the iffy cover, that makes it difficult to manage. This is a fight that you want to take very slowly. You want to make sure you are hitting those health thresholds at the exact moment that you are ready for them. Make sure everyone is alive before progressing any thresholds if it's possible. Don't be afraid of using the bottom floor either. A lot of people are going to be playing on the top floor because that's where most of the cover is, but downstairs has a little bit of room to run and a little bit of room to hide with the giant platform in the middle. But I don't recommend staying down there for long. The only thing down here will be Cursed Thrall, and they don't really behave very different than usual. They're very passive. Don't forget about the orbs of power in the water either. They will eventually time out, so after you burn a super or something like that, check to see if there are orbs on the ground for you to scoop up. This is a very difficult strike because of the instant death potential. This is the only time I will actually acknowledge the everything one-shots you crowd, because everything is so lethal. Most things are not a one-shot, but you should treat them as if they are. If you want to see a full run of the strike, I have one uploaded that you can go watch. It's linked everywhere. Best of luck in there. Thank you very much for watching. I will see you next time.